Hey, this is Dr. K from iMedicalSchool, and today we're going to talk about heparin induced thrombocytopenia, otherwise known as HIT. So the first question is, what is thrombocytopenia? Thrombocytopenia is a fancy term that means a low platelet count. Platelets are fragments of larger cells found in the bone marrow called megakaryocytes. The function of platelets is to help form clots to stop bleeding. Now, heparin-induced thrombocytopenia is when heparin, an anticoagulant agent that we really use commonly in the hospital, leads to a drop in a patient's platelets. Now, there are two types of heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. There's type 1 heparin-induced thrombocytopenia, which is a non-immune-mediated process. In some people, heparin causes platelet activation, leading to a partial consumption of platelets. If you continue the heparin, the platelet count returns to normal within a day or two. Now, type 2 heparin-induced thrombocytopenia is an immune-mediated process and will be our focus for the rest of this discussion. So, type 2 HIT involves the formation of heparin platelet factor 4 complex antibodies. We will discuss how these antibodies play a role in the development of immune-mediated thrombocytopenia a little bit later. But keep in mind, HIT type 2 is a very rare disorder and can lead to thrombi, including arterial thrombi, that are very platelet rich. Of all the patients you see, only 5% are likely to develop HIT who have a prolonged exposure to heparin. An important point to note is that your patients on unfractionated heparin have a higher risk of developing HIT than if they're on low molecular weight heparin. Risk factors for immune-mediated heparin-induced thrombocytopenia include a long duration of exposure to heparin, exposure to unfractionated heparin, being female, and a history of recent surgery. So let's discuss the physiology of HIT. Platelets have a receptor called a platelet factor 4 bound to their outer surfaces. When heparin is introduced into the bloodstream, the heparin binds the platelet factor 4 receptor. Generally, if a patient had a previous exposure to heparin, they may have developed an anti-heparin platelet factor complex antibody. This antibody binds the heparin platelet factor complex. The heparin PFR, or platelet factor receptor antibody, when bound to its target, can activate other platelets. So the activation of platelets can lead to thrombi or clot formation, as well as consumption of these platelets by the body. Now that we've gone over the physiology, let's talk about how to diagnose heparin-induced thrombocytopenia type 2. If a patient with a current exposure to heparin has a 50% drop in their platelets after 5 to 10 days of exposure, this would indicate this patient likely has HIT. Now keep in mind, this time frame may be shorter if they had a previous known exposure to heparin. Other important findings that are indicative of HIT is if your patient develops a reaction to heparin. These reactions to heparin include necrotic skin lesions, tachycardia, dyspnea or difficulty breathing, chills, and fevers. Remember that patients with HIT are hypercoagulable, so thrombi can develop. Thrombi include DVTs, PEs, otherwise known as pulmonary embolisms, limb gangrene due to arterial thrombi, and finally, cerebral sinus thrombosis. The serotonin release assay is the gold standard for diagnosis of HIT type 2. The way the serotonin release assay works is that you take your patient's serum, who you suspect has HIT, and mix it with platelets that have a radio-labeled 14-carbon serotonin. When these platelets are activated, they release the serotonin with the 14-carbon radio label. The radio-labeled platelets are mixed with your patient's serum, and the combination exposed to heparin. If your patient has HIT, the heparin will lead to activation of platelets and release of the 14-carbon serotonin. If the radio-labeled 14-carbon serotonin is detected, then you have a positive serotonin assay for HIT type 2. Another test used to detect HIT type 2 is the platelet aggregation assay. In this assay, we take normal platelets and mix them with the serum of your patient with suspected HIT. We then introduce different doses of heparin into three samples. If the patient has HIT, then at low levels and at therapeutic levels, there will be low aggregation and high aggregation respectively. At high doses, no aggregation occurs as the heparin PF4 antibodies become overwhelmed. Now that we've discussed how to diagnose HIT type 2, we will discuss treatment. If you suspect a patient has HIT, stop all heparin injections and products. Keep in mind, certain devices may be lined with heparin, so just stopping their injections for DVT prophylaxis may not be enough. Given these patients are hypercoagulable, they need to be started on a direct thrombin inhibitor, like argatroban or bivalirudin. Argatroban has the ability of being able to be used in renal insufficiency and hepatic insufficiency, while bivalirudin generally can be used in hepatic insufficiency. Do not start warfarin or low molecular weight heparin for anticoagulation. Once a patient has a confirmed HIT study, then you can bridge them with a direct thrombin inhibitor to Coumadin. INR goal is 2 to 3, with duration of therapy being 2 to 3 months in patients who've had HIT with no thrombus, or 5 to 6 months in patients with HIT and thrombus. Alright, that was a review of heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. I'm really looking to cover subjects you request as viewers, so please leave a topic down below and we can discuss it in a future video. If you like this video, share, like, comment, and subscribe. Check out our podcast on iTunes called iMedicalSchool. Follow us on Facebook and Twitter. This is Dr. K, and I'll see you next time.